So that was already a treat, and I wish we could have presented the whole 2.5 hours. And, you know, it's really worth knowing that there's almost no Dastangoi now who performs solo like that for 2.5 hours. So I think since the art form pretty much died out, this is the first time that there's a storyteller as powerful as Mahmood who can keep anyone riveted enough for 2.5 hours. As I said, you know, this is really giving Bollywood and everything else a run for its money. It was that riveting, you know, so big hand for Mahmood. I've asked Anusha to tell us when he is next performing so that we can all go en masse and get our punya, you know. Well, so we're now going to invite both Mahmood and Anusha Rizvi onto stage, as I said, for the conversation. But just before that, a little bit about Anusha, who we have not introduced, and she lost her dramatic entry getting someone else an air purifier. So we owe her a dramatic entry. You know, so like I said, as Mahmood is that kind of disruptive cultural figure that we really need in our country, Anusha is one as well. She was, you know, in that godforsaken profession we called journalism, which is really as dying a tradition as Dastangoi was, and there are no revivalists for that one. But Anusha, you know, moved away again from that comfortable profession of television journalism to do a film that I really, and this is not because we keep speaking in superlatives, but is one of those films which really captured, I think, one of the big crises in India today, amongst the many other crises, which is the urban-rural chasm, you know, the imaginative divide that separates us from the real India. And Peepli Live captured that absurdity of the media, not just the media, but in the way that we conceive of other people's realities, the way the government tries to not assuage it. And as I said, dark, satirical, but really at heart, a redemptive and human story. And Peepli Live is, again, if none of you have not watched it, please go back and watch it in whatever medium that you can find. So, and Anusha, of course, is also the producer of all the Dastangoi shows that Mahmood does. And they are trying to transform it, and that is their generosity of spirit, not just from a show that is predicated on Mahmood as a storyteller, but into an art form that others can take up and enliven and expand. So really, this is a big celebration of both of them. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming them both on stage.
Thanks so much.
Thank you for being here. And, you know, since you were doing a piece from the Mahabharata, I want to start actually the great war between your two families. I just want you to know that Anusha comes from a Shia Muslim family and Mahmood comes from a Sunni Muslim family, and they are both also literary warlords, you know. They both come from extremely literary families, and there was a Mahabharata between them as well. So let's hear about that first. Anusha, you go.
You go first. Okay, so So my uncle S.R. Farooqui is the greatest living Urdu writer, and he belongs to an Urdu camp which is called modernism, jadidiyat, and this came in the 60s after progressivism had held sway in Urdu culture for a long time. And progressivism, the progressive writers movement in literature, in theater and various arts was the scene that dominated India. So where writers were asked to write about exploitation in society, the class divide in society, writers like Manto, Bedi, Ismat Chughtai, verily the who's who of Urdu literature and poetry in the early, in the mid-20th century. And Anusha's grandfather, Ghulam Rabbani Taba, was one of the stalwarts of that movement. And he was also the secretary of the Progressive Writers Association for a long time.
General Secretary
lifetime. And since 1960s, sorry?
General Secretary lifetime.
And the progressive writers, my uncle came, made his literary career attacking the progressives from the 60s onwards and just laying it to shambles and creating a space for modernism. So he was dismayed at the fact that, I was marrying into the progressives at one. And my father was doubly dismayed because my father was also, apart from being an Urdu poet, is also a slightly orthodox man. So he thought that all Shias are dubious characters, you know. And he turned out to be quite correct, not just because of Anusha, but other people that I worked with, you know. And but he was also, he was particularly perturbed that not only is he a Shia, but he's also a communist, you know, which is like a double jeopardy, for double whammy for him, you know, because communists obviously are godless, you know. So although there is a contradiction between being a Shia and a communist, and my father should have chosen one, because if he was a communist, then he couldn't have been a practicing Shia. And if he was a Shia, then he couldn't have been a practicing communist. But when I said this, when I put this to my father said, yeah, yeah, he's a communist. But then at the end of it, he's a Shia. And Shia will leave everything, but we'll never leave his Shiaism. So that was you know, and but you know,
you're not telling the main part, Mahmood, which is that Anusha's father got Mahmood's father kicked out of a job.
No, my grandfather.
Yeah. So that they were also, you know, so I mean, as you know, Shias are, because the word, very word means faction, you know. So they are into factionalism and they're partisan and they're into groupism. So my father was editing a literary magazine in the early 90s and he had published a letter by someone after Ismat Chughtai's death. The letter was a little unseemly, but he didn't write the letter. But Anusha's family was at the forefront of a campaign. They raised a question in the parliament also to get my father removed from that post, you know. So, but I don't know what to say after that, but
well, initially, he refused to get his name on the card because he couldn't believe that his son is the eldest one, is marrying not into a communist family, but a Shia family. But eventually came around, he did put his name down on the card.
So this was a great entry point into the whole Dastangoi tradition, because Dastangoi stories are mostly about love and war. So the two exponents of it really represent love and war. So Mahmood, you know, before we come to the current piece and how it came about, if you would just ease the audience into this whole tradition in the first place, that what are the kind of root books out of, or not, they were not books, that was oral tradition, but what are the original stories and what does it tell us about that time and that society? And it's fascinating that Amir Hamza, which is the main character, was the uncle of the prophet, you know, and then there's sorcery and trickery and all of that. So it seems so different from the kind of picture of Islam that one carries. What does it say about that society?
Right. So dastans are stories like any other epics, you know. They're stories about love and war, razm and bazm, all great epics, Ramayana, Mahabharata, Iliad, Odyssey. They're mainly about love and war and adventures. So the story started from the about 8th, 10th century in Arabic and Persian. People started narrating the stories of the uncle of the Prophet Muhammad, Amir Hamza, who was known to be a very brave man and a very courageous man, and stories of his valor and his adventures and travels. And at some point, another character called Amar Ayyar, a trickster, got associated with him. And the pair went around the world, their picaresque journeys and their conquests and travels. And this was very popular in Persian and popular across Islamic and medieval regions, you know, popular in Morocco, popular in Indonesia, popular in Bosnia. And in Bosnia, you know, so these stories were told and recited all over the world. And the unique thing was that they were not told as poems, as poetry, not in verse form, because a lot of medieval stories are told as verse forms, you know, like the Ramcharitmanas or the Alha Udal. But this was told as a prose, you know, where storytellers just use their voice and their performativity, often not even moving their hands as much as I was moving. And then they came to India in Emperor Akbar's court, and Akbar was so enamored by these dastans that he commissioned some of the leading painters of his atelier to paint images of the Hamza dastan. And they painted large images, you know, images by about a yard and a yard and a half in size. 1,200 of those, you know, that this is the greatest artistic project undertaken at Akbar's court, out of which only about 100 survive now. So these stories were there, they were around, they were popular. In around the 18th century, they began to be told in Urdu. And what the Urdu storytellers did was that they started innovating and expatiating and expanding, improvising on what dastan was popular all around the world. So whereas we had a single volume of Hamza dastan, the Urdu storytellers, through their oral recitations, began to expand it. So much so that, you know, they grew, they created a whole genre called tilism, which was not important in any other part of the world. And tilism is a kind of a magical realm that a magician or a sorcerer creates. This is something you might, some of you who know Chandrakanta, Chandrakanta Santati may know talisman, ayyari, because Chandrakanta was itself an adaptation of the Amir Hamza Dastan. So in the 19th century, when print came to North India, the leading publisher of North India, Munshi Naval Kishore, and a publisher whose publishing empire remains unrivaled in the annals of the world. I don't think Oxford University Press has the kind of range and has brought out the kind of volumes that Munshi Naval Kishore did between, say, 1857 to 1940. Munshi Naval Kishore was publishing religious stories. He was publishing scriptures from Punjab to Calcutta, Sikh religious scriptures in Gurumukhi, Sikh religious scriptures in Urdu, Hindu religious scriptures in Urdu and Hindi. He was publishing in Sanskrit, publishing in Arabic, publishing in Persian. So there's a famous scholar called Ulrich Starkey at Chicago University. She has aptly called his empire, his thing, an empire of books. So Naval Kishore, seeing a potential in these oral stories as published book artifacts, he commissioned the leading storytellers, the leading Dastangos of Delhi, of Lucknow, who were reciting the story orally, to start, you know, narrating it to scribes so that it could be put down in print form. So we don't know too much about how this process happened, but we have one anecdote about a great Dastangu, Ahmed Hussain Qamar, who in one single moment would be dictating stories to 8 different scribes. So 8 different points of the story of the single volume, and 8 different scribes are taking it down. Yaha isko choda, par agla sentence bola, par agla bola, par agla bola, par agla bola, without missing a beat. So these storytellers were actually writers as well as performers, because when they were performing on stage, they were improvising, because they were masters of creating poetry, masters of description. They could just go into rhapsodies about a flower or a garden or a fair or a romantic dalliance, or even, you know, a kind of amatory exchanges, or even love scenes, you know. So when Naval Kishore started publishing these volumes, the first volume came out in 1883. It was so popular as a book that this tradition went on. He went on publishing more and more and more and more series, until by 1910 he had published 46 volumes of this Dastan-e-Amir Hamza extended cycle, and each volume was over 1,000 pages. Wow. This is 46,000 pages of a single story, a single, you know, story cycle. Nothing of this size or caliber has ever been printed anywhere in the world. And all this emerged from oral traditions, you know, people describing and telling stories. Now, one of the reasons why you and I don't know anything about it is obviously because what happens after 1857 and the coming of the British is a kind of a recasting of our letters, a recasting of our literature, a recasting of our culture. Now, there are two wonderful books by great scholars. Sudipto Kaviraj has written a book called The Unhappy Consciousness. And Sudhir Chandra has written a book called The Oppressive Present. So what happens after 1857 as the colonial encounter? Please keep these two titles in mind, The Unhappy Consciousness and The Oppressive Present. That is the situation, that is the present, and that is the consciousness that we are living with, where we have sort of been cast asunder from our traditions, and we've been told not to respect and not to valorize and not to value our own traditions. So a poet like Tulsi Das, who frankly should be enjoying the stature of Shakespeare in this country, is not known, not recited, not heard, not read, not shared on stage. So there is a kind of a dichotomy between our traditions and histories until 1857 and what happens after that. So Urdu writers themselves devalued this whole tradition, because the colonial Angres said, oh, this is all useless, this is all fantasy, waste of time. You know, fiction should be like a novel, which should teach you something. So there was a new demand from literature, that literature should have a moral purpose. Now, if you start judging literature like that, you would be forced to put all of Kalidas aside, which is actually what we have done. So, I mean, I challenge you, any of you, to name, you know, 3 plays of Kalidas.
Challenge.
Meghdutam. Abhigyan Shakuntalam, Malvikagni Mitra.
The 3 is done.
Well, but then, you know, 20 people combined to give me 3 plays, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
But he's written 7 plays that we have come down to us, you know. So,
anyway, so my point here, that was, you know, so Urdu writers, the colonial angrez came and said, oh, look, he's talking about kissing that woman. He's talking about, you know, are isme to itna vulgarity hai, isme to itni obscenity hai. All this is all nonsense, you know. So Urdu writers said, oh, all this is nonsense. Urdu writers said, our poetry is nonsense because our poets are conceited. Which lover cries so much, you know, that, you know, uska rumal bheeg jata hai aur aasman se barish hone lagti hai. Aisa to natural hota nahi hai. So Hali, one of the great reformers of Urdu and Islam, said, no, we should do natural poetry. In fact, Urdu writers, poets came up with a term called naturey poetry.
Naturey.
There was a whole movement called naturey poetry. Poetry should be natural. And poetry should be about nature. So Kalidas wrote a lot about nature. Obviously, as you know, he wrote about the clouds and everything else. But they said, oh, this is nonsense, you know. Nature should be written about as Wordsworth has written it. So our poets, forgetting all their thousands and thousands of years of traditions, started trying to write like Wordsworth.
So, and progressivism is also part of that, by the way.
So, we'll come to the love story later. You know, let's stick with the war right now. So Anusha, yes, you know, I just want to share a quick story about Mahmood. You know, someone asked him that why did he give up the safety of academia and does he miss academia to have taken up Dastangoi instead? And he said, are you crazy? You know, the wah-wah that comes from the audience and that whole experience. And he said there was one performance he was doing where he was talking about a story about a woman who goes to a lover and she comes back and she finds her husband is waiting at home. So on a sudden impulse, she wants to tell him everything. And apparently from the audience, 6 or 7 voices came out saying, nahi. So
yes, that happened during Chauboli, which is Vijay Dandetha's great folk story. And that is another story in itself, you know. But,
I'll use that so, you know, I can understand Mahmood's, you know, enjoyment of giving up academia for reviving this. But Anusha, you have really dedicated your life as well to supporting this. So, and you know, you come from a communist Shia background. Did you find this political enough? Do you find it, you know, does it satisfy all your senses? What attracted you to giving up your life to support this so much?
See, initially when we began this, we got married and we immediately gave up our jobs. We were complete idiots. We had no money. We had given up our jobs and we were trying to find something. I don't know, we were looking for something. We were sure somehow that there is something that we are not doing right now, which we need to do. And in that search, Mahmood found this book by Shamsur Rahman Farooqui, which was about Dastangoi, and he started reading it. I was not familiar with it at all, but it was only his enthusiasm for that I, solely as a designer, as the costume designer, as a set designer, I decided to come into that. And we were using a lot of our resources. I mean, we obviously we've never taken any grants from the government. We don't believe in state grants. So we were using all of our money. The props were from my own house, things like that, you know. So for me, it was actually a very gradual process. And I think
it's okay, you can tell us that it was love of Mahmood that drove you to it, you know.
Initially, but very soon, you know, in 2006, what happened was, and as you said, politically it does have a lot of resonance for me, because in 2006, Bant Singh had happened and his hands were chopped off and he was brought to Delhi. So we were trying to raise money for his treatment. He was in Delhi and we personally had no money. We were completely broke. So that was the first time that Dastangoi went into the political mode that a lot of our Dastans now today in 2018 are, whether it's partition or sedition. So we did the first change of the traditional Dastan for Bant Singh, and we tried to raise some money for his treatment. And immediately after that, Urvashi Bhutalia contacted us for, it was going to be 60 years of partition. And she wanted us to do something on partition. And that's when we started writing the partition Dastan. Okay. So
Mahmood, I just want to...
I'll just take a minute actually about, you know, whether this, about the politics of what Dastangoi is, you know. I mean, as and lots of people have said it, but Terry Eagleton said this most famously, the great Marxist critic, you know, who was at Oxford when I was there, that, you know, everything, including the choice of your toothbrush, is political. This goes beyond, you know, saying the personal is political. Personal, of course, is political, but everything that you do, in fact, what we are seeing right now in this room,
this room is permeated by the politics and power relations of the last 150 years. The shoes that you are wearing, the clothes that you are wearing, the chairs that you are sitting on, the stage that we are sitting on, the lights that we are using, the space that we are at,
language,
the way we are sitting, everything, the language you are speaking, everything here is deeply permeated by the unequal political structures of the last 150 years. So politics pervades everything that you do and you touch, especially if you belong to a colonized country. But Dastangoi is a little more than that, you see, because when Anusha designed the show, we are bringing back Angarkha, which is a fairly elegant sartorial style, fairly elegant dress, which has now become passé, for no good reason really. I mean, the Japanese still wear their kimono, you know. It has become passé for no good reason. The long pajama that we use, that she has used, has become passé for no good reason. Ghalib wore that pajama, but at a certain point in the 19th century, they felt that pajama was too outlandish. Our pajamas should be more like the pantaloons that the British are wearing. So Aligarh, which is a very modern institution trying to make Englishmen out of us, starts this style of pajama which is shorter, which is actually known as the Aligarh cut. The topi that she used in that is a dupalli topi, which was very popular until we were growing up, until at some point in the 80s with the Gulf connection, that topi began to be replaced by the kind of skull cap, which has now become a byword for Muslims, which is actually a kind of an adaptation of a Jewish skull cap. So the dupalli topi, the angarkha, the costume that you wear, is a very conscious political choice which tries to disrupt contemporary Muslim practices, contemporary appearance of Muslim. At the same time, sitting on stage and wearing a topi goes against the kind of secularism that we like to practice, because we like our secularism to be denominational. It shouldn't be denominational in that sense. The stories that we are performing are stories that have been marginalized from the canon for very political reasons. The language that we are performing in has been marginalized from the canon for very political reasons. So everything about Dastangoi is actually deeply political. It's not raising slogans about, you know, but it doesn't have to raise, everything political does not have to raise slogans. So I just wanted to point that out.
No, in fact, that was exactly what I was going to ask you. So in a way, it answers everything that I was going to ask you, that it doesn't have to be obviously political. Everything in its restoration is political. But, because we were saying that when we were watching the Karn teaser, it felt so contemporary. It felt as if you were watching, like, maybe Indian Parliament or just the public discourse around you right now. And Anusha mentioned the Bansingh Singh story. Very quickly, this was a pig herder whose daughter was raped. And when he stood up to speak for his daughter and to ask for justice, he was pulped in the farm, and his hands and legs were beaten so badly that he's completely amputated. Both his arms and one of his legs has been, both his legs and were amputated. And he's but now a big resistance singer, from a big Dalit resistance singer. And that's how they were raising funds for him. But
that's really our first foray into the actual, physical political form of Dastangoi comes from Bansingh. And it's
sure. So, I'm going to come to you, Anusha, just in a minute. What I wanted to ask you, Mahmood, though you explained how in itself restoring this is a political act, but, you both have moved away now to doing, say, stories about Binayak Sen, sedition, partition, now the current story. But the original tradition was all about story within story within story, sorcery, exuberance, bombastic, baroque, all of that. So do you think you're under pressure now to play out your communist kind of leanings? Or are you managing to keep the beauty of the original in the contemporary stories that you're taking up?
Yeah, it's a tough one, you see, because the stories that I write are nowhere near, the class of the traditional stories. In any case, any tradition of craftsmanship which has been cultivated by hundreds and thousands of artists over centuries will ipso facto be better than anything that any individual can create. That's obvious. This is something that that Walter Benjamin had said. That something, if you take a piece of, for instance, the kind of brass work that you see, intricate brass work, intricacy upon intricacy upon intricacy. That kind of craftsmanship is actually trying to imitate the work of eternity itself, you know. The way an ocean works on sand, for instance. It's not, so the traditional dastans have a beauty, have a play of language, and have a freedom, that an unfettered freedom that it's not possible for me to have that kind of imagination. But at the same time, they come in the package of a language that is not so easy for audience to understand. So it has got to be a balancing act between telling stories that are more obviously, more superficially resonant, and telling the traditional stories which demand a little bit from the audience. So you have to create an audience base. It's like, you know, suddenly, you know, today I'm telling the Karna story, and at least the audience knows what is the Mahabharata, knows who is Arjun, knows who is Krishna, knows who is Karn. So to that extent, my job is easier in telling the Karna story than if I'm telling the Amir Hamza story, because the Amir Hamza story is like a flowing river. So if I start, you know, then I have to tell you where the source of the river is, who are the major characters, what happens in these stories, what is the formula, what is that we are witnessing today. So as in oral narrations, you know, the audience is always already familiar with what you're saying. I just have to start saying, aur jab Dashrath ne usko nikala Ram ko vanvas ke liye. If I start at this point, my audience in India already knows the background and already knows some of the stuff that's going to happen. But I can't do that with the Hamza story. So there is a challenge in that. So there's got to be a balance between you know, telling those stories and telling this story as well.
So, you know, I'm going to come back to you, Mahmood. The first, I just want to bring Anusha in. And I want to come back to you about the audience, you know, that what was the kind of audience? And I asked you earlier, what did it say about Islamic societies at that time, which is very different from, say,
Absolutely.
And in fact, Anusha, that's something that maybe even you can answer, that when you were reading it and I was asking you what was attractive about it, what did it say to you about the Islam and the possibilities at that time, and say the Islamic, construct within which people live now, both non-Muslims as well as Muslims, you know? And the second question I wanted to ask you was, both of you went through an extremely traumatic time when Mahmood was accused of rape and was, you know, in jail. And the story of Karn came out of that. So I'm going to ask you about that. But first, if you can just answer this question about what the stories say about Islamic Muslim societies then and the kind of societies that we live in now.
Well, clearly, even for us who have been very, very familiar with Islamic cultures, which are prevalent today, these stories are very surprising, because the kind of elements that they bring out seem extremely modern and extremely, sometimes not at all at, this is not something our imagination of an Islamic society, even within India or a modern society, was. So the kind of language, the kind of, the role of women, that's really, really attractive to me, because not only are there warrior women, a large number of the characters are women. And these are not abla naris, okay? They all have their own armies, they are really, really enterprising women who go out there to win areas and win land for their masters. It's really actually empowering to read those in terms of only as women, if you see this, and the kind of roles that they're playing and the kind of administrative roles that they have within these stories is very, very fascinating for me.
There is this. I mean, these dastans. Obviously, you know, everybody drinks in these dastans. These are supposed to be Islamic stories of adventure. Amir Hamza is the great uncle of the Prophet Muhammad, but he's, you know, freely drinking, and he's, you know, obviously having numerous affairs and doing all sorts of un-Islamic things. At one point, Ahmad Hussain Qamar suddenly feels that, you know, all this is not correct, you know. So he says in this dastan, what is this nonsense, you know, hum dikha rahe hain Amir Hamza ko sharab peete hue, wo itne hamare bade Puritan figure the, unko hum sharab peete hue dastano mein kaise dikha sakte hain, ye galat baat hai, aaj se Amir Hamza ne sharab peena chhod diya. And then 200 pages later, he says, वैसे तो अमीर हमजा ने शराब पीनी छोड़ दी है, लेकिन शराब के बिना बज़्म कहाँ और बज़्म के बिना दास्तान कहाँ, तो हम फिर से अमीर हमजा को शराब पीते हुए दिखाना शुरू कर देते हैं. So there is a latitude in these dastans that Shoma was trying to bring out. There is a kind of, these are stories of Islamic adventures, but these are Islamic adventures which do not conform in any way to our understanding of Islamic cultures and societies. And actually, that is not a very
a flippant point. The one of the great books about Islam that has come out in the last 10 years is a book by Shoaib Ahmed, a scholar who passed away at the young age of 46. He was at Harvard, polyglot to beat all polyglots. You know, he knew Persian, he knew Arabic, he knew Punjabi, Sindhi, French, German, Latin, Greek. He had picked up all those languages, and after 25 years of study, he wrote a book called What is Islam? And it opens with an episode at the University of New Jersey, which is that university, Stanford? No, Princeton. At the University of Princeton, there is a British scholar of Islam who's sitting next to a Muslim professor, and the Muslim professor is drinking. And the British professor turns to him and says very politely, you know, I just wanted to ask you. He says, what? He said, excuse me, aren't you Muslim? He says, yes, but you are drinking. He said, yeah, I'm drinking, you know. My ancestors have been drinking for 1500 years, you know. So there is an Islam that surprises us, because we'll see it from the constraints of what the constraints of present-day Muslims are, or what they practice. But, you know, it was a very different world before 1857, is again what I was trying to say.
So, you know, I'll come to the Karn and your entire experience in jail, Mahmood, but how, because you've been performing this now for almost 10 years, how have audiences been receiving it? You know, has there been a kind of discomfort within Muslim communities? Have some of the clerics, anybody tried to stop you? Has there been any backlash at all, or do they just see it as so outside of the tradition they don't care?
No, there has been no. I mean, whenever we have performed not only to Muslim audiences, because, you know, the problem with our performance is that the audience who come to the theater don't understand much Urdu, and people who understand much Urdu don't actually come to the theater, because, you know, people who understand much Urdu do not have the bourgeois class which can go to the theater. Perhaps 20 years later or 30 years later that may happen. So no, we have not had any objections from anyone, because you see, if you go to any mushaira today, I can tell you with confidence that you will see at least 40% those beardies from madarsas. And those beardies from madarsas hugely enjoy the poetry which is full of references to whining and love and music and stuff. You know, there is no problem with that, you know. Because what you expect from your art and from your literature is the same thing. You know, I was witness to this in Jamia a few years ago. The great Pakistani poet Ahmed Faraz standing up on the stage at 1:30 at night in the Jamia auditorium, which has a lot of these fundu-licking Muslims, you know, with their skull caps and their beards. And Ahmed Faraz gets up on stage at 1:30 at night with a Bisleri bottle and says, Hazreen, isme sirif pani hai. And the whole audience, the mullahs are going, wah, 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 wah. So there is, you know, so the people are not only, you know, even if they have a beard and they have a skull cap, that doesn't mean that they don't have a taste for poetry. It's always been true, you know. Jigar Muradabadi, one of our great poets, wrote some of the greatest poetry odes to drinking after he had given up drinking, you know. So there is this part of our tradition that you operate in. We've not had that kind of an objection from anyone. Perhaps, you know, one day we might have a fatwa which might make me famous briefly with non-Muslims.
No, you should tell them about Chaucer Kamba and
yeah, we performed, you know, yeah, we, you know, in Chaucer Kamba and, you know, in Nizamuddin, and there were lots of Muslims there, you know, who are, so why, I remember I was performing Chauboli, and there was, you know, and I don't know why people can't do Azan at one same time, you know, because 10 mosques doing their Azan one after another, so.
And this is then, when you were starting the Shiv Stuti.
I was just, in the Chauboli, there is a Shiv Stuti, you know, there is a ode to Mahadev, which I picked up from an 18th century music text, you know, Mahadev, Devan Pate, Parvati Pate, Ishwaresh, Neel Kant Champanan Dukharan Vam Dev Ganga Shikhar Jata Jood Damru Dam 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 Baje Sukkaran. Aur usi main usko jo hai thoda main push karne ki koshish kar raha hu, improvise karke, ki azan khatam ho jaye to fir main usko shuru karu. Aur wo azan chal rahi hai, fir maine Shiv Stuti shuru ki. Usse majboor ho gaya, kya karta, time hi nahi tha, to maine Shiv Stuti shuru ki. Aur samne mere panchve row mein ek mulla baitha tha jo keh raha hai dusre mulle se, abe utho yaar, isha ki azan ho gayi, chalna nahi hai kya namaz padhne. To wo wahin baithe hue sun rahe hain. So I mean, people are complex, you know. People can have, you know, I mean, it is possible, as we know, Hitler was very fond of classical music, you know, which is supposed to be purify you and exalt you. And, you know, it's yeah.
So, Mahmood, just, you know, we'll come to different aspects of the Persian and Urdu storytelling tradition, but because we just watched the Karn piece that you did, this came out while you were incarcerated in jail, you know, and watching you today, it was really like witnessing the most transformative capacity of art, because it was just so redemptive that you turned such a difficult time into something so beautiful. But can you tell us about, you know, you could have picked 100 other stories. Why did the Karn story insert itself into your mind? And then you've drawn from so many traditions. Can you tell us different ways in which you have incorporated all of that?
The story actually began with Anusha, you know. Tell us about what, that department, Urdu department, that, no, the Hindi.
So Mahmood was in jail, and randomly I got a request to do work on Das Mahabharat from, I think, the DU History Society or something like that. And by then, the whole of the media was doing all kinds of things with us. They were putting up articles which were like really flawed, and we didn't know what to do. There was no way we could, we had, according to the media, no story to tell. And in that situation where you're not allowed to say anything, we were not allowed to speak, we were not allowed to have any version of our own truth, that is when this thing came up. And I went to Mahmood and I said, I think you should, this is what you should need to do. This is, and at that time, some, you know, dates were coming up, and how courts are, every time we try and go there, there would be a new date. There were no, judges were not willing to listen to our case. One judge had recused himself. And we didn't really know what was going on, what is going to happen. So at that point, I asked him to start working on Karn and start doing the Dastan on Karn. And you'll have to take it.
Yeah, so I was doing a lot of theater in jail, you know. And uske pehle main keh dun, aaj din aap logon jo log mere case se waqif hain, hum ne bachpan se filmon mein dekhte aaye hain ki baizzat bari kiya gaya. Mujhe bahut beizzat bari kiya gaya high court ke zariye. To uske liye to ab main kya kahun, lekin behrhal bari hua to main bari hua, uske liye main shukrgozar hoon. Lekin main, I was in prison and I was doing a lot of theater in prison. And prison library has, I have written about that, that library and my interaction with it, has three shelves of religious literature. Ramayana ki puri series hai, Mahabharata ki puri series hai. And I had done Ram Leela in prison before that, which was a wonderful experience. Again, I have written about that. And I had done some work with the Ramayana, as Shoma said in the beginning, I had worked on the 300 Ramayanas, that wonderful essay by A.K. Ramanujan, and I had a dastan called Dastan Jai Ram Ji Ki. So when Anusha mentioned this thing, you know, it was 2 weeks to go. So I thought, why not give it a go? Thoda Mahabharat padke dekhte hain ki kya ho sakta hai, kya nahi ho sakta hai. So I had always been fascinated, like everybody else in India, I think, by the character of Karn. You know, he has an appeal that transcends the Mahabharat itself, because he has been discriminated against, he's marginalized, he has got this angst, he has. Injustice has been done to him. He's a kind of an anti-hero. So everybody roots for Karna, and that is, it's not a surprise why so many writers and poets in the 20th century and beyond have picked up Karna to work on. Ramdhari Singh Dinkar, Mrityunjay by Shivaji Savant, several others, you know, texts that people have worked on. So I was fascinated with Karn from childhood, and had always rooted for him. So when she said, this opportunity came to do something, you know, it was at that time, it was important that kuch hamari, something, you know, some narrative which talks about something else that we are doing, some other work that we are doing, you know, something else of the work that we had done. So I decided to give it a go, and I started actually reading the Mahabharata, which was available in prison, published by, as all Hindu religious texts are, by Gita Press, Gorakhpur, which is my hometown. And there were these big tomes, you know. So then I started and I said, I'll restrict myself to Karn. And I had a few people in my group already. So we started taking out those references. Then I remembered I had performed some excerpts from Rashmi Rathi, Ramdhari Singh Dinkar's great poem on Karna at school. So I had those two things to begin with. And I knew that Akbar had done a translation, Persian translation of the Razmnama. And when I was out on bail in 2015, I had written a small book on the great Pakistani writer Intizar Hussain, with whom I started with, you know. And Intizar Hussain was unique among Urdu writers and among Indian writers in general, because Intizar Hussain did a lot of work around and using Hindu mythology while in Pakistan.
And he did a lot of work with the Jataka, Buddhist Jataka stories. To my mind, there is no writer in South Asia who has actually presented Buddhism more beautifully to a contemporary audience than Intizar Hussain. So when I was doing that book on him and reading up his writings, I came across these Urdu translations of the Gita done in Pakistan, and several of these other kinds of counter-intuitive traditions that existed within medieval Islam. So then I started work on that, you know, and I started, you know, researching, and then I wrote. And I, at that time, I didn't seem to me that anybody would perform what I am writing. But I just wrote it, you know, and by the end of it, I had, you know, filled 3 or 4 copy books of it. Then we, you know, it's difficult in prison to get things photocopied, but I somehow managed to get a photocopy done and smuggled the registers to Anusha, because you're not allowed to give and take paper unless it's a legal document. So I had to, you know, push it in.
We definitely have a story of all kinds of smugglings that we did from jail.
But only paper.
No. Only written words.
Mahmood and Anusha, don't get carried away and say things that might land you in trouble again. Yes. Smuggling is not the word you want to use. No. There was art transfer going on. Yes.
So those registers came out, but it was not possible for anyone to perform because of the length, the complexity of language, and the sheer scale of the narrative.
Also, I just wanted to add that, you know, the registers were coming, and as he was writing, so there are 4 registers in which he's written the dastan. So he would give me, I'll get 1 register somehow, and then we'll try and type it out. And because it was written by hand, there was always that difficulty to figure out each and every word, how to edit. And then eventually all the 4 registers make a huge story. So how to edit that? Because once I have the typewritten thing, to take it back into jail, because it's in Hindi, and it's all right to, you know, for the policeman to see all the English papers and say, okay, chalo. But the Hindi, they know. Okay, and now how do you get that in to get the editing done? All of that was kind of interesting.
Was a story in itself. Anyway, so I did those things. Then I that time, and then its first performance, actually a 10-minute version just of the battlefield which I narrated, ended on, was actually done by 2 inmates of my drama class, because when I was there inside, there was a Tihar Kala Abhiyan where we, you know, the then Director General Sudhir Yadav tried to showcase our performative artistic endeavors to the city at large. So we had these 3 Delhi hearts where singers, dancers, and actors from my group performed outside. So 2 inmates did a 10-minute version, a premiere of it inside prison. And that's, then when I came out, this is Mahabharata is an oral, it started as an oral recitation, oral epic, you know, it's something to be told orally. And within the Mahabharata, every story is being told by someone or the other. There are multiple narrators. Somebody comes, wo ped ke niche gaon ke aake baitha, kisi ne usse pucha, to Maharaj, ye kaise hua tha? So he starts telling that story. Jaise Vaishampayan is the narrator in the beginning, then other narrators take over. So it was always meant for an oral recitation. But somehow it has got lost, and we still have traditions of Ramayana being told as an oral epic. But Mahabharata sunna sunane ki practice kaafi hadd tak khatam ho gayi hai. So it was crying, it was, you know, if you're a storyteller, you're living in India, Mahabharata was always on the agenda. I had written about it in the first Dastangoi book that I brought out. Kisi din tamanna hai ki kisi din Mahabharata ki dastan sunaye. Ye nahi pata lagi us tamanna ko pura karne ke liye itne lambe raaste se guzarna padega.
So Mahmood, I'm going to come back to you to share some of the more exuberant, you know, so again the audience gets a sense of the original tradition. But before that, Anusha, you know, we were talking about how the Karn piece that we just saw felt so contemporary, it felt so real, it felt like a comment on our current times, you know, and particularly on Dalit politics, it really resonated. So when you, and as you said, you've been working for a decade on the whole Dastangoi tradition, what does, and you mentioned the women characters, when you compare, you know, the feminism of that time with, say, the kind of feminism that plays itself out now in contemporary terms, you know, what would you critique? You know, is the feminism now more modern and that was progressive? Or, you know, was that more modern and have we fallen down the ladder now?
Well, it's a tricky one, Shoma, and you know that. But I certainly feel this is not more progressive than what we had. we certainly had a more progressive feminism, if you that's what you want to call it. Today, what we have is...
I was just saying, empowered women, which is different from, you know... So there are usually empowered women in these dastans.
And what we have today is not empowered women. We have women who are using victimization as a tool, although they have all the powers in the world and all the policymakers standing by them. And that is an issue with me, because that, I think, is totally Catherine mechanism of some sort. What we are moving towards is trying to use women more and more as victims, while what we should be seeing them with them is not victimhood only. What we should be seeing is enterprise. What should be seeing is empowerment. None of that we see today. What we see today is totally what was envisaged by McKinnon, and I have a huge issue with that.
Sure. So Mahmood, just to come back to you, you know, Anusha, I'm going to keep trying to switch because both of you are powerhouses and I'm trying to do this fairly. But Mahmood, you know, we were saying about capturing the kind of exuberance of these stories. Could you share some of that, you know, of the original stories and how fantasy itself is a kind of political statement? Because through all this sorcery and trickery and that sheer baroqueness, these two characters go and kind of create a righteous domain at the end, you know? So can you
I mean, you know, ultimately it is, you know, dastans are fantasies, you know, but fantasies obviously have a kind of realism in it, because, you know, when they depict a bazaar, they depict a bazaar of 19th century Lucknow. When they depict a mela, there is a mela in which there is a bhang seller, there is a afim seller, there is a charas seller, and they all speak in their particular languages. So there is obviously when a woman fights with a husband, there is a speech of 19th century Lucknow, and those women are quite vocal, by the way. I mean, you know, so there is the fantasy element is obviously, as always, fantasy is political, because fantasy is making a comment about the contemporary world always, you know. When they describe an emperor like Afrasiab, who's the king of sorcerers, and the description goes something like this, ki wo tilisme hoshruba ka badshah hai Afrasiab, jiski amaldari mein 60,000 mulk jadugar aur jadugarniyon ke abad hain, ki badshah un sab mulkon ke Afrasiab ke muti aur minqad hain, aur us tilisme hoshruba ke 3 hisse aur maqam hain. Pehla hissa hai pardae zulmat, ek andhere ka parda hai jo hazaron hazaron meel tak phaila hua hai. Us andhere ke parde mein bade bade buzurg Afrasiab ke rehte hain, har waqt tapasya karte hain aur naye naye jadu inaam mein paate hain. Phir ek tilisme batin hai jo aam aadmi ko dikhai nahi deta hai, aapko samajh hi nahi aayega ki ye tilism hai, aap tilism ke andar pahunch jate hain. Phir ek tilisme zahir hai. And then Afrasiab ka jo description dastan ko build karta hai ki tilisme zahir aur batin ke darmiyan ek darya khincha, कि जिसे दरियाए खूने रवा कहते हैं, और उस दरिया पर एक पुल धुएं का बना है, और दो शेर अंदर धुएं में पुल के ऊपर खड़े हैं, और एक इमारत 3 दर्जे की धुएं की उस पुल के ऊपर बनी है, और उस धुएं की इमारत पे जो बनी, अब सोचिए आप, खून का दरिया है, उस पे धुएं का पुल है, दो शेर धुएं के पुल पे खड़े हैं, एक इमारत 3 दर्जे की धुएं की बनी है, पहले दर्जे में उस धुएं की इमारत के परिजादे शहनाइयां और करनाइयां मुंह से लगाए खड़ी हैं, दूसरे दर्जे में उस धुएं की इमारत के परियां झोली में मोती भरे खड़ी दमबदम उछालती हैं कि मोती दरिया में गिरते हैं, और दरिया की मछलियां उन मोतियों को मुंह में लिए इधर-उधर तैरती फिरती हैं, और तीसरे दर्जे में उस धुएं की इमारत के बड़े-बड़े कद्दावर जवान कौम के हबशी दो-दो सफे बांधे खड़े बाशमशीरे बरहना आपस में लड़ते हैं कि खून उनका बहकर दरिया में गिरता है, कि पानी उस दरिया का वही खून है जिसके सबब से नाम उस दरिया का दरियाए खूने रवा है, और नाम पुल का पुले परी ज्यादा है. सो ये मैजिक, तो दिस इज मैजिक, एंड इट्स आल्सो मैजिक रियलिज्म, व्हिच आर मॉडर्न क्रिएटर्स ऑफ मैजिक रियलिज्म आर टोटली पेल शैडो ऑफ दिस, बिकॉज़ आई हैव जस्ट डन अ दास्तान जिसमें एक जादूगरनी है, उसका नाम है सहाब दरियाबारी. सहाब कहते हैं बादल को. अब वो जब जादू करती है तो उसके आंख से आंसू बहने शुरू होते हैं, और फिर वो आंसू बहते हैं, वो आंसू इतने बहने लगते हैं कि वहां एक दरिया बन जाता है, हर तरफ एक जो है तूफान आ जाता है, और एक फ्लड आ जाता है, और दूसरे सिपाही सब उस फ्लड में डूबने लगते हैं. दिस ये मैंने आपको जो 4 लाइन में बताया है, ये 4 पेज का डिस्क्रिप्शन है. उस 4 पेज के डिस्क्रिप्शन में जबान की जो बारीकी है, और जो वर्ड प्ले है, और जो पन है,
It's impossible. I don't have enough knowledge, but Shamsur Rahman Farooqi knows his Shakespeare and knows his John Donne and knows his Keats, you know. Magar kisi writer mein itni salahiyat nahi hai ki 4-5 page tak aise khinchta rahe metaphor aur imagery sirf pani ki, wo tufane nooh ka koi muqabla tha, aashiq usme gir raha hai, kua hai, chaah, ab wo keh raha chaah, chaah aapko lagta hai chaahat, lekin har ek ko usme girne ki chaah thi. चाह का एक मतलब होता है कुआं. सो द काइंड ऑफ वर्ड प्ले, द काइंड ऑफ लिटररी मास्टरी दैट दीज राइटर्स हैव व्हाइल वीविंग अ वेरी इंट्रिकेट स्टोरी, दैट इज एब्सोल्युटली यूनिक. आई मीन आई डोंट थिंक देयर इज एनी ट्रेडिशन इन द वर्ल्ड एनीवेयर दैट कैन कंबाइन दैट काइंड ऑफ हाई लिटररी एंडेवर विद अ मास पॉपुलर अपील. यू नो दिस ओनली शेक्सपियर हैड दैट इन 16th सेंचुरी ब्रिटेन.
Okay, let's open this up to audience. We could go on forever, but let's take some questions from the audience. Are they on the phone? Oh, I'm so sorry. I don't think I haven't had time to ask a question. Okay, so then does anybody want to put up their hands? I'm sorry, it's dark and I can't see. Yes, there's one there. You haven't forwarded it to me, I think. Why don't you just ask while I quickly fix that gap?
Any insight on the current chief minister from?
Oh, yeah, right.
It's just by chance he happened to be.
He's about my age. I went to Government Jubilee Inter College. I don't think he went there, otherwise, I would have known more about him. But I was lucky enough to go to school with. I don't know if you remember, but in the early 80s, Gorakhpur's last, before Yogi Adityanath, Gorakhpur's last great claim to fame was ki 1981 mein Gorakhpur ka naam BBC mein aaya tha as the most highest crime infested city in the world. Kyunki us time pe Virendra Pratap Shahi aur Ravi aur Harishankar Tiwari ki badi rivalry chal rahi thi aur Harishankar Tiwari ne Virendra Pratap Shahi pe goliyan chalwai thi aur uska Musalman bodyguard tha, usne 17 goliyan khayi thi, Virendra Pratap Shahi ko bacha liya tha. लेकिन बाद में शाही जी मर गए थे. आदित्यनाथ उस जमाने में हमारी उम्र के रहे होंगे, क्योंकि आपको पता है गोरखनाथ मठ की रिवायत है कि वहां पे गोद लिया जाता है लोगों को और फिर उनको ग्रूम किया जाता है. तो बाबा इनके पहले जो थे महंत अवैद्यनाथ, वो गोरखपुर में रहे थे. तो हमारे कुछ फैमिली दूर वाले हैं, मतलब जिनके उनसे थोड़ा बहुत मिलना जुलना था, क्योंकि एक जमाना था कि जब RSS वालों में भी शराफत हुआ करती थी. तो आपकी पॉलिटिक्स कुछ भी होती थी, आप इंटरपर्सनल रिलेशनशिप चलती थी आपकी. बहुत से लोग हैं, हमारे एक दोस्त हैं अपूर्वानंद, उन्होंने 2 साल पहले इंडियन एक्सप्रेस में बड़ा अच्छा पीस लिखा था कि उनके फादर घोर कम्युनिस्ट थे, मगर एक साथी उनके थे RSS वाले, उनकी दोस्ती हमेशा कायम रही. और ये अनुषा के फादर भी इलाहाबाद में पले बढ़े, उनकी भी दोस्ती कुछ ऐसे RSS वालों से थी, टंडन जी का खानदान था, वो दोस्ती अपनी जगह चलती थी, वो रिवायत और पासदारी अपनी जगह चलती थी, पॉलिटिक्स अपनी जगह चलती थी. लेकिन अब अफसोस की बात है कि वो रिवायतें धीरे धीरे काफी हद तक खत्म हो रही हैं. जैसे राजीव गांधी मरे थे तो मुझे याद है टीवी में देख रहा था तो अटल बिहारी वाजपेयी ने कहा था कि मेरा उनसे बहुत मतभेद था, लेकिन जब मैं बीमार हुआ था उन्होंने अलग से मुझे बुलवा के मुझे अमरीका भिजवाया था, सरकारी खर्चे पर मेरा इलाज करवाया था. तो वो एक 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 रिवायत, एक पासदारी थी जो अब बहुत हद तक कम हो गई है. तो वैसे तो बाबा आदित्यनाथ का जो गोरखनाथ मठ है, एक्चुअली उसके आसपास मुसलमानों की बड़ी घनी आबादी है और वहाँ उनके उनके कुछ ताल्लुकात हैं. इससे ज़्यादा मैं जानता नहीं हूँ, और जानता भी हूँ तो यहाँ से नहीं बोलना चाहता.
On that, sorry, the questions haven't come in. If there's anyone else, otherwise we'll close.
Yeah, I have more questions.
एक
साथ पूछ लेता हूँ. तो सेकंड क्वेश्चन इज टू बोथ ऑफ यू कि आपकी लाइफ में पैसे का क्या रोल है पर्सनल लाइफ में?
बहुत कम, बहुत कम.
रोल बहुत है लेकिन मिलता बहुत कम है. देखिए पुरानी कहावत है, हमारे शास्त्रों में कहा जाता है, जहाँ सरस्वती जी रहती हैं वहाँ लक्ष्मी जी नहीं आती हैं, और जहाँ सरस्वती जी रहती हैं वहाँ लक्ष्मी जी तभी आती हैं जब आप 20-25 साल सरस्वती जी को रख सकते हैं, उनको खुश रखते हैं, तब कहीं जाके लक्ष्मी जी आती हैं, और उसकी भी कोई गारंटी नहीं है.
तीसरा क्वेश्चन है कि वर्ल्ड वाइड देयर इज अ माइक्रो ट्रेंड टुवर्ड्स मेल अब्यूज, Do you feel that the micro trend is there?
Yeah, let's stick to the art forms today.
Last question is, how did you handle your mind when you are being punished for a crime that you did not commit?
Actually, in some senses, it was easier for me than it was for Anusha, because I was inside, I was protected from all the nonsense that was being going around in social media and people around. I was the prison obviously is a hugely miserable space, but फिर भी मैं वहाँ मेरे कुछ साथी थे जिनके साथ मैं अपना काम कर रहा था थिएटर कर रहा था तो उस जिल्लत में भी थोड़ी बहुत इज्जत मुझे मिल रही थी बट इट वॉज वेरी डिफरेंट फॉर माई फैमिली आउटसाइड फॉर अनुषा आउटसाइड इन मेनी वेज आई थिंक देयर स्ट्रगल वाज मोर डिफिकल्ट देन माइन यू नो
एक्चुअली आई फील दैट बिकॉज आई न्यू महमूद वाज ऑलराइट इन देयर एंड आई कुड सी हिम एंड ही वाज फाइन एंड ही वाज वर्किंग दैट्स व्हाई आई वाज ऑलराइट टू फाइट दैट केस आउटसाइड एंड you know, day in, and the case was really for 2 years. It was 10 in the morning to 1 at night, really in that. But the only reason I or his mom or my mother could just push ahead and keep day after day after day do it was because we knew he was all right inside. So if he was not all right, I think it would have been difficult.
No, it's you know, I mean any. जवाहरलाल नेहरू ने एक लेटर में लिखा था जवाहरलाल नेहरू ने आप लोगों को शायद याद ना हो 14-15 साल मेरा ख्याल है जेल में गुजारे हैं सच में गुजारे हैं उन्होंने एक लेटर में लिखा था कि ये मजिस्ट्रेट्स जो हमें इतनी आसानी से जेल भेज देते हैं इन्हें इनको कम से कम एक एक हफ्ता जेल में गुजारना चाहिए तो इट्स प्रिजन सिंस द मॉडर्न प्रिजन केम इन टू बींग 1790s 1780s ऑनवर्ड्स इट इज अ वेरी मिजरेबल एक्सपीरियंस एंड You know, I recently, a few months ago, I did a show called The Gallows Project with some of the former inmates, and I did a recitation of Oscar Wilde's great ballad, The Ballad of Reading Jail. And there is no more moving account of a prison experience than what Wilde has written, you know. I know not whether laws be right or whether laws be wrong, but this I know, all we know who live in jail is that the walls are strong, and that every law, but this I know that every law that men have made for man, but straws the wheat and saves the chaff with a most evil fan. This too I know, and wise it were if all would know the same, that every prison that men have built is built with bricks of shame and bound with bars, lest Christ should see how men their brothers maim. So, it is a what shall I say? हम किताब लिख रहे हैं पढ़िएगा उसको
On that note, you know, I mean, just the way that Mahmood, it's just the photographic memory you have, Mahmood. There are many things we want to salute you for. First of all, to again bring back to us the redemptive power of art, the redemptive power of the human spirit, the redemptive power of love and war. And really, thank you very, very much for being here today and for reminding us of what we are losing. In our great desire to create a mall culture where we forget where we've come from. So thank you very, very much for that.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, Algebra. Thank you, everyone.